them once, you've already built that trust. There's just many more opportunities to get bigger and better and more lucrative projects.
Hello, Sales Nation. I'm Will Barron, host of the Salesman Podcast, and welcome to today's show. On today's show, we have Dan Englinger, and we're talking about mastering account management, not just plodding along. And this is especially important if you are new to account management as well. There's a lot of actionable takeaways in today's show. You can find out more about Dan over at salesschema.com. His book, Mastering Account Management, is available on Amazon. And with all that said, let's jump into today's episode. Hey, Dan, and welcome to the Salesman Podcast.
Thanks for having me on, Will. Appreciate it.
You're more than welcome. Excited to have you on. I'm excited to dive into account management with you. I know you've got lots of thoughts and ideas on this, and so I'm intrigued to pick your brains and pull out the best bits for the audience. And I'm going to start with a massively loaded question that's going to set up the whole of the rest of the conversation that we're going to have. And that is, why, in a nutshell, so we'll break it down further, but why, in a nutshell, should the audience care about driving new business from current customers versus just continually prospecting for new ones?
You know what? That's funny, because I don't think that's a loaded question. I think that is, people already know the answer to that, which is that you've already done the hard work. You've already convinced them once, you've already built that trust. And there's just many more opportunities to get bigger and better and more lucrative projects because you've already made things happen. My question is, I think the better question is, why don't more companies invest more in continuing business with existing customers?
And why is that? I assume, as you've asked it, I assume you know the answer.
I have some hypotheses. I'm not sure I know the answer. One hypothesis is that it's a little bit uncomfortable sometimes to follow up with people that you formed, you know, these close collegial bonds with. At least I found that personally. After you get over a certain hump in terms of your early sales training, it's not that bad to talk to strangers and kind of try to convince them to buy. What's harder is, you know, going to somebody that you know well and asking them to open up their wallets again. Also, I think that there's just not enough good reasons that people create to do continuing business, and it often feels kind of forced and awkward, which is a problem that we try to solve.
So let's just touch into this and that first point you made, because I think this is really interesting. I've never discussed this on the podcast before, but what's going on between the seller that you did, the prospect that you did, or the customer that you're dealing with currently? What's going on in the psychology behind you not wanting to approach them for more business? Is it that people don't feel like they've done enough, and so that ties into it? Or is it that there's less ego involved, perhaps, in that if someone that you've never spoke to before rejects you, you can brush it off. You can think, well, they were wrong. They were an idiot. I didn't want to deal with them anyway. Whereas a current customer, it's, you know, if they say they don't want to deal with you the second time around, they're making a judgment on the actions that you've taken, right?
Yeah, and I think that people get caught up in the projects too, because there's, you know, with any engagement, there's going to be ups and downs. It's very rare that everything is copacetic the whole time. You know, there's going to be little problems, but overall, even if it's great, there are going to be issues. So I think that's a big thing, is that people, especially salespeople, get a little bit less confident when they're dealing with somebody that's already, you know, taken on a product or a service, because you don't really know where you stand. So I think that's part of it. And the other side of it is just kind of an information disconnect. And it just depends on what you're selling, the structure of your organization, and different factors. But you may not really know what your clients think of what they've purchased. So you're kind of just dealing with this black box and just going right back into the same sales scenario that you started with, which isn't necessarily the way to do it.
So let me reframe this slightly then. And who is responsible for selling to the same people over and over? Is it the company's responsibility to have the products to enable the salespeople to do this? Or is it more squarely on the shoulders of the salesperson to make it happen regardless?
I think that there's different ways to structure it depending on your industry. I think that regardless, there needs to be cooperation and coordination between account management and sales. I think that account managers, whether they're also salespeople, you know, hunting new business, need to be trained in sales and need to be incentivized. And I think that if it is siloed, that if you do have somebody winning new business, maybe that's more of the SaaS model and so on, and then that kind of gets shuttled off to an account manager, there needs to be ongoing cooperation between those parties so that everybody knows where things are. And I keep running into, you know, I've run into problems a lot with clients and just other people that I know, or, you know, they'll mention offhand, like, you wouldn't believe what this account manager would slip by us almost. You know, there was this huge mid 5-figure website build that they just mentioned offhand, like it was anything else. And I say to them, you didn't give them any reason to care. You know, they don't think of themselves as salespeople. They don't know how to look for those opportunities. They don't know what to do when they come across them. So why should they tell you about them? You know, why should they be on the same page as you?
And who, okay, let me just take a step back and reframe the whole conversation, I guess. Who should be, and obviously it's organizational, it depends on the company and the structure as a whole, but who should be a stakeholder in continuing to sell and look after current customers? Is it the original salesperson? Is it the account management? Is it customer service? Is it marketing? I'm assuming the answer is all or above.
It's hard to give a specific answer because I think it's going to have to depend a little on the industry, but I think it's who's ever kind of at the forefront of the client relationship. So, you know, if you have a system where it's sold off to an account manager, then that person is the one hunting new business within that specific department or within that account, I think.
Okay. Right. So I want to get real practical about this because I know, and you cover this in your book very, very well. So I want to dive into if we can systematize or process a size, I don't think that's a word, I just made that up, but to put a process in place to allow this to happen versus my experience of account management in medical devices. I both hunted new business and then managed the accounts, and we had a small geographic territory around our house because we had to go into theaters and the operating rooms and spend time with the individuals. So I was doing both. And what I found was it's easier, or there's more in sales. People tend to understand the sales funnel to get new business, but there doesn't seem to be any specific industry-wide standard of a funnel to keep people happy and to sell them new products after the fact, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think so. And I'm gonna have to paint in broad strokes a little bit, but I'll get as specific as I can because there still isn't a one size fits all model for everything. But I think the most important starting point is going after the right customers, or at least kind of applying your hardcore account management process on the people that are going to be more likely to repurchase or to purchase bigger, better things from you or whatever that may be. To identify those customers, I kind of like to boil it down to three things. Where do you already have existing leverage? Where have you created these huge wins, clients singing your praises and so on? You know, B, where's their market growth? Where are the financial winds blowing? Are there major problems or blood on the street or something like that? And then C is kind of receptiveness. You know, all things being equal, where are you having really smooth sales cycles? Where do people just kind of get it and things just move along really well? So once you've kind of identified, maybe it's just one or two groups or even just one to five accounts or whatever it may be, then those are the people you want to apply this process to. Because if you apply it to everybody, you're not going to have time for much else. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the first step. The second one, which I kind of mentioned earlier, is making sure that account managers and salespeople are on the same page. I think account managers, if they're not also salespeople, need to be incentivized and need to be trained at least on some level in sales. And then from there, I think it's really about defining, you know, the long-term path as part of your normal process. So to get specific about that, in more of the creative services agency space, we used to highlight a debrief call. So we'd say, first, you know, we're going to have a discovery, then we're going to go through all these steps, and then at the end, we're going to have a debrief process so we can make sure, you know, to get you the best results long term. And that kind of gives you a new chance to requalify them, find new areas of pain, ask them how they're going to use the product and so on, so that you're not left with the just checking in problem. And so I think that's a good place to leave it. And then from there, I think a lot of mistakes that people make are sort of making it all or nothing. So they're going for, you know, another big repurchase of their flagship product. And if that can't happen, then they're like, oh, well, that, you know, I guess we'll check in a year and see what's new. But there's all sorts of other things you can do. Like you could go for a big repurchase. That's a huge win. There might be ancillary upsells. Maybe if you sell website builds, maybe you have an SEO partner or something. You could get referrals. You could build case studies. One that I love in particular that's super easy is that if they have pain or just problems related to something related, you know, that you can't solve, bring them into your personal network. Make intros to people that are close to you because that kind of brings them into the fold. I've met so many salespeople that treat their customers like precious gems. You know, nobody can get close to them, but it's just the wrong move because if they have problems that you can't solve, they're going to go somewhere. It might as well be within your orbit.
And what value does that, just to play devil's advocate of that for a second for, because there'll be people listening who'll be thinking this, just so you can spell it out, because I understand this, but what's the benefit of you allowing these connections and keeping people within your ecosystem? What's the benefit of you making these connections when you're not making money from it, if that makes sense?
Because they're going to go somewhere to solve their problems, most likely. So it's going to be somebody that they're going to, you know, if they need to get traffic to the website you just build, they're going to go to a Facebook marketer. It may as well be somebody that you're close with, and the benefit, I think, is that it's more likely to come back to you. You know, you're going to stay on their radar. Your partner that you introduce them mm-hmm. to is more likely to suggest your services again when they need the next, you know, microsite or whatever it may be.
And again, getting real practical with this so the audience can put it into place, because they're probably driving to the next sales meeting or they're on the way to the office right now as they listen to this. If your company doesn't have these industry partners, should you be making these industry partners with other sales reps in other companies or other account managers in other companies? Should you proactively do that yourself so you've got personal connections to share? Is that the smart move, or does that give you the opportunity to perhaps be undermined and not have the backup of the company behind you?
I think that you should be doing that anyway. And the worst case scenario is that you're networking and you're doing all the stuff you should be doing and hopefully get some referrals out of it as a worst case. I think that if you're specifically looking for a partner relationship and there's lots of complexity involved and there's going to be lots of admin and heavy lifting and stuff, maybe it makes sense to first figure out if your customers, or at least your high value ones, need those other services. Otherwise, you know, you could spin your wheels and find and set up all the stuff that nobody really wants. So you might start with there. You might just start with doing a little customer development, doing a debrief call, like I mentioned, and figure out what they really need.
Definitely, definitely. Okay, so something you mentioned earlier, which I want to dive into, is going after the right customers. So you give us 3 points here of 1, leverage, 2, market growth, and 3, receptiveness. Now, assuming, and this isn't the case for 80% of the people listening, but assuming everyone's got a really healthy pipeline or real healthy customer base, so that we're not kind of scraping the bottom of the barrel with all of this, are these 3 things elements that we should be looking for, or are they things that we should proactively be trying to develop? So should we be trying to leverage more points of leverage, more wins, spitting these back to the prospect or the customer so that they know that the wins that we've had have been documented, whether it be a quarterly report, whether it be an email, whatever it is? Should we be proactively doing that? Or if we've got a healthy pipeline, is there enough context and content there to just go out and cherry pick customers using these 3 moments, these 3 points of measurement?
Yeah. And if I understand the question right, I think that the point that where you actually can have some effect is with leverage. So you can be doing things to make the customers sing your praises. And that's definitely on the account management side. So if that's not something you handle, then like I mentioned earlier, you know, you want to be in touch with your account managers to figure out which groups are already doing that. And if none are, then what can they be doing differently to make that happen? The other 2, market growth and receptiveness, I think are a little bit more outside of your control, but that just takes some sort of creative thinking and monitoring. For example, I guess more along the third one, when I was in creative services doing selling high-end animated video services, a great niche for us or kind of a decent one was financial services niche. You know, they were interested in video. They were creating videos pretty often. There was some degree of market growth. We had 1 or 2 good wins. First 2 boxes got checked. The third one was always such a pain because they were just kind of old school. They didn't, every single sales process was kind of convincing them what, you know, an animated video was. So we ended up sort of in, that's the thing, is it's not like we gave up on going after that niche, but in terms of this sort of time intensive account management process, they didn't fulfill the prereqs. So I think that's important, is that keeping in mind that you don't have to do this with each and every group or each and every client. It's sort of figuring out that sort of Pareto principle, 80-20, cream of the crop sort of thing.
And obviously this depends on how many customers you've currently got or how big your pipeline currently is. But how many people should we be targeting on this, this next level of account management, I want to call it, rather than just being the polite, doing everything that they ask for? How many people at a time can we handle when we're trying to like master the account and really sink our teeth into it?
Yeah, it's hard to say without knowing the specific industry. I guess for me personally, it was usually just a few accounts or a few groups at once. And I would kind of think of them, I'd have maybe two or three that had already purchased from us a few times. And I knew that there was a lot of potential throughout the organization. And that would also kind of qualify them for me to, go forward with this process. There was a big management consultancy that had bought a bunch of videos from us, and I knew that there were so many other departments. So what I did there was stayed in touch in order to build case studies, not in order to get more business, but we want to be tied at the hip to your results. We want to have skin in the game. And they understood that. So they would make intros to other departments without even me asking them. And then it just sort of snowballed from there. So I think that's one example.
Well, let me stop you there. Yeah. Let's use that example. If you can talk about it, not mention names if you don't want to, but what's the step-by-step process you went to, and what was the end goal you were trying to achieve, and did you achieve that end goal with that particular account? I think it'd be good as a mini case study for this show, so people can have the context of, you, Dan, as the expert, what you did to leverage and really, master that account.
Yeah. I mean, the process was basically what I described. So that client was worth going further with because they checked all those boxes. And I, in terms of number two, I was a jack of all trades because we were a tiny company. Like, we started as just me and the founder. So I was already handling sales and account management and all sorts of other stuff I shouldn't have been dealing with. and then from there, it was sort of just, defining the debrief as part of the normal conversation, getting back on that call, finding out how.
And when did that happen? Huh? How many weeks after the original deal had been done or the product delivered? And I want to just get really practical because
so that was probably within a week or within 2 weeks after we had delivered the final version of the video, was getting on the call and finding out where we stood too. That's another good point, is figuring out what went right, what went wrong, making sure they didn't hate our guts for some reason we didn't know, which can happen because you're not always privy to what people won't always tell you. People like to avoid awkward situations. So sometimes you have to pry it out a little bit because you want to find out then so you don't waste your time following up with somebody that doesn't trust your organization anymore, So that was important. And then you get more specific, from there, I wanted to find out how they were going to be gauging the success of the video. Was it going to be views? Was it going to be engagement? Was it going to be leads? So we found out more about that, and then the next step was, can we be in touch within a reasonable time for you to gauge those results? So that must have been roughly a month or so. And then we just kind of kept doing that until we got enough information to build a case study, which they were happy about on some level because they knew that we cared enough to do that, and they probably got a minor promotional benefit. And then
there again. I'm going to be jumping in and out here, so please excuse me. But when you say case study, is this using them as a public demonstration of the effectiveness of your product?
Yeah, exactly. Which sounds one-sided at first glance, but I think the benefit to them is that they know that you care enough to do that, to be on the hook for their results, even if you're not going to give a refund or anything like that. Just being there is huge. And I'll see if I can do this example. I've written it out. I might butcher it, so if I start going on down a rabbit hole, sorry. But basically, it's sort of like, if somebody was opening a restaurant and say you're opening a restaurant and you have all these different vendors for the grand opening. You have somebody that's, providing the oven, somebody that's providing all the tools, somebody that's doing all the promotion, somebody that's doing all the the culinary stuff or whatever. And they're all just sort of doing their jobs and going through the motions. But then the person who constructed your oven is contacting you, before, during, and after to make sure that it's still working right. Who are you going to be more receptive to when, you need to buy one for your second location because your launch went off like gangbusters? So it's just sort of like, you being there is huge. The problem is you can't be there for everybody. So you gotta pick your battles.
Yeah. Okay. And just before you move down, if there's any further in the kind of the relationship that you had there, are there any other ways to keep, I hate the phrase, but to check in or keep in touch with your current customers? So you've given us one there in kind of putting essentially a customer testimonial or results driven testimonial together. Are there any other ways to do this that aren't that disgusting email that we've all had that just goes, "Hi, just checking in, effing all right, and there's no kind of value to that email, is there?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think the main thing is to be proactive and to sort of lay out the process so you don't have to do that. So that means being in touch for reasons that are relevant to your buyer, you know, so that's, can we follow up to gauge your results of this thing? Can we talk about how we can, you know, further increase the success you've had with it? Those are the most intuitive that I can think of, but there might be others that, you know, it could be treating, like I mentioned earlier, not treating your customers like they can't ever talk to anyone else outside of your company. Hey, we noticed that a lot of customers that buy our sites also need SEO. This is, you know, can we talk briefly about that? We have some ideas for, you know, improving what you're doing in that realm. Any, it just has to live in their world. You know, as soon as you say just checking in, they know that you just want them to buy again. You're selfish and irrelevant. So as long as it's relevant. And if you sat down and thought about it, if you thought of your successful accounts, I think almost everybody listening to this podcast could think of something that's relevant and interesting to get in touch about. Yeah,
definitely. And then getting practical, I like this idea of asking how you can further, you can add to the further success of the company that you're dealing with, the customer that you've got currently. Because you could potentially go to a bunch of your really good customers that are going to be more open and more honest, and there's a relationship there that you can go back and forth with. And you can ask them that question. And then for anyone else that you're trying to nurture as a and to grow the account, you could then use the data that you've got from the people that you've got trust with that are going to be open and honest with you, because they might turn around and say, at the moment, no, there's not real much. So you need to, perhaps that's a wider company question then of what can the company do to add more value. But they might say, there's a bunch of instructions you can make. There's this, there's that. You can go through to the people that have not that need nurturing, that aren't at that point yet. And if it's relevant for your best customers, it's more than likely going to be relevant for everyone else, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. And I think another good point to bring up is that, you know, like I mentioned, you've already built this trust. You've already done all the hard work. And if you're doing a B2B sale, especially in a large organization, you're not selling to the founder. There's only one type of sale that, you know, you're dealing with, and that's, is this going to get me fired? That's the what they're worried about. And you've already kind of shown that it won't. You know, it's gone well enough once. Why wouldn't they put their reputation on the line by making a referral to somebody else in the organization or doing it again? There's no safer bet than you, assuming you're in relatively good standing.
And I don't think, and tell me your thoughts and experience on this as well, Dan, but I don't think salespeople see it as that a lot of the time. I think so when I was selling to the NHS, so the healthcare system in the UK, half the time you'd be dealing with theatre sisters and nursing staff and surgeons. And the other time the other side of things, you're dealing with professional buyers. And the buyers, their only concern is not getting sacked. They don't care about the quality of the product. They don't care really about the price. All they care about is your reliability and your ability to deliver what you've promised versus, you know, they get screwed over, and then they've got the genuine opportunity to kind of be out on the streets or out on their ass. How do you think that salespeople understand that this is a real important imperative for the buyer? That it's not really so much about the product, the service, or what you're going to do for them. Like a good 50% of it is just that they can trust you. People are going to pay way more if they know that they can just trust the product or service that you're offering.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And to answer your question, I think that some salespeople do. I think you have to kind of learn it through experience that's the dynamic, or at least I did. You know, I thought that it was all about how much things cost and ROI and the delivery of results. And when you're dealing with founders or owners, that is a little bit more true. But what I found was that even if it was such a minuscule amount of money, if it came as a surprise, it would completely throw the train off the tracks and things would go terribly. Like, oh, we have like, you know, a few seconds of overages, it's going to be a couple thousand extra bucks or whatever it was, that would end terribly, because we took for granted that there were all these admin systems going into place and I'm blanking on it now, but when they set up a specific amount of money that's supposed to be spent on a project and it goes over, and we just didn't think about that. We're like, yeah, but the fact that if it had just been brought up, if we had built that into it, it would have prevented so many problems. So I think a lot of the times salespeople have to kind of learn that through trial by fire, because it's going to be a little bit different in every industry and every situation, like what those surprises are, you know, especially when you're dealing with large organizations that have like very specific systems in place. But you can learn them is the good news. You know, if you talk to your main stakeholders, they'll tell you exactly what they're up against, but you just have to ask.
Definitely something I found, and it took me experience and time and reflection and understanding the psychology of it all for it to sink in, even though it was obvious, was the it sounds so obvious, even though I'm like, because I know what's coming in my head, I'm laughing. It sounds so obvious that in B2B, people aren't spending their own money. They want the result, they want the trust, and they expect, you know, for not to be screwed over by, you know, additional costs being thrown on top that they've not been, you know, explained that is a potential opportunity. And that obviously that goes without saying. But it took me a long time to understand that when you say the price is XYZ, they're not thinking, that means me eating beans on toast for a week because I'm not going to be able to afford it. It's, you know, and the flip side of it all is if the deal is good enough, most, you know, decent sized B2B companies, they can find the money and the cash as well. So the cash is almost irrelevant as long as it's in context to the product and the value that you're giving them. And that took me ages to suss out.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, sometimes if you get into those situations and you just ask and they say, sorry, you know, this is too, I want it, but it's too much money for our budget. Or you can just ask them, you know, what has this happened before? What have you done when this has happened before? When you want something that's out of budget, and they're like, well, you know, I guess we go up the line, take it out of XYZ budget or something. So, but I think you're right. I think that a lot of the time salespeople kind of have like one foot into entrepreneurship and they're just not thinking like that. They're thinking about, you know, we're on the hook for producing results in every single instance, which isn't really the case with a lot of B2B transactions. It's mostly about keeping people safe.
Definitely. So I want to just cover one last topic before we wrap up here, Dan. And that is, because I know we have the guys doing the lead gen, the SDRs. I know we have what I was, which is like an all-in-one kind of like sales machine. And then we have account managers as well listening to the show. I don't need to be pointing fingers here, but I think it's a relevant question to ask. If your job is to generate leads, to close deals, and then you hand off to an account manager, if that's the process, how often are the salespeople who are, you know, they get paid on closing the deal? So a lot of the time they will do whatever it takes to close the deal. How often are they screwing up the long-term business by like over-promising and then the account manager has to deal with under-delivery?
That's a great question. I guess from what I've experienced through different offhand conversations and clients and things, pretty often that's a pretty standard objection or thing that owners of companies and account managers complain about is the salespeople over-promising. And I think that, my hunch and what I have, you know, would like to see happen more, because I think it can happen, is companies taking steps to stop that by, you know, basically making communication a little bit more mandatory between salespeople and account managers, and creating processes that can kind of make that work. So I think that it's something that can be prevented if companies care to prevent it, and if they're willing to say no to projects where that could only happen through overpromising.
Definitely. Okay, Dan, I've got a couple of questions, mate, that I ask everyone that comes on the show before you tell us a little bit more about your website and where we can find out more about you. First one, other than your own, what is one book or resource that you recommend to the Salesman Podcast audience?
Yeah, well, I mean, one lately that I found helpful is Start With No by Jim Camp, which is actually a negotiation book, but it's helped me a lot in sales because it's all about sort of outcome independence, you know, so sort of treating each sales call as if you were a poker player. And poker players will celebrate how well they played, even if they lose really badly, because they know that if they keep playing that way, they'll win more times than not. So that sort of just helped me be more relaxed and enjoy myself. So that was my main takeaway. There's all sorts of other good negotiation stuff, but that's been great lately.
And let's just touch on that for a second, because this is something that I'm super passionate about and I've never done a full show on it, and it probably deserves it. What happens when you're dealing with a customer when you have as we touched on before, a really full, fat, affluent pipeline, when you understand some of the psychology of becoming outcome independent? What happens to your interactions with the customer when you've got all this lined up with you?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think it plays out a lot of different ways, most of which are better than if you're scarce, you know? But obviously, you know, you're more relaxed, you're more calm. And I think you're willing to be more honest. I think when about how you can actually help them, and you're more willing to say no when you can't. So you create a lot less headaches for yourself in the long term. The trick is learning how to be like that even when your pipeline's not that full, you know? So that's the challenge.
I find it almost counterintuitive that it's not the less you care, that's not what I'm saying, but it's the less that you are not even focused on, because you want the deal to close, but it's the less that you feel pressured to make it have to happen. When you feel like that, you close more deals because the prospect and the customer that you're dealing with feels in their guts that stress. They feel it's slightly weird. They feel like they're being perhaps pushed and manipulated, even if it's on a very surface level. And so they wonder what's wrong. Versus when you know your product's great, when you've got a great pipeline, or when you've taught yourself the psychology of it all so you can do it without that, which I can't. I need to have a big fat pipeline to feel confident in what I'm selling. But when you can do all that, the customer feels nice, they feel relaxed, they feel like, well, you know, if they don't close with me, they're just going to go to someone else. And the whole pressure of the whole situation, it's changed. It's a totally different selling scenario, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And I think one way to do that is to just sort of like rate yourself based on how you think you performed just to yourself on each call, regardless of if it closes or not, you know, regardless of what of the actual outcome. If you can just sort of say, like, I did great on this call. It wasn't a fit, but I don't feel bad. I asked all the hard questions. I did what I was supposed to do. Mm-hmm. Then you can kind of start building that muscle a little bit. At least that's what's worked for me lately.
Definitely, definitely. And Dan, I've got one final question for you, mate. So I'm going to ask everyone that comes on the show. And that is, if you could go back in time and speak to your younger self, what would be the one piece of advice you'd give him to help him become better at selling?
Yeah, I think, you know, I would say stop looking for shortcuts and lean into the scariest thing every day. I think that when you're new to something, you're looking for some sort of sweet hack that's going to make it easier. Like, I'm going to make this crazy CRM machine that's going to like just deliver me closed business. But it's usually through the scariest thing that you're going to learn and make things happen.
How do you manage this? Because this is something that 2017 is a year of me putting processes into place for the business to both make the getting guests on board and the communication and all that kind of easier, because it's not great at the moment, and growing the audience as well. I'm very conscious that the people that I've interviewed who are super successful, the other podcasters who are doing crazy numbers that I'm kind of talking to behind the scenes, it's all process driven. My problem is I get bored of processes in an instant, and I've got the grass is greener on the other side syndrome, where I constantly want to experiment, because I really love the experimentation of things as well. How did you, or how do you kind of implement this process first approach and getting the basics and the fundamentals right with all of this?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I might plug my buddy's system a bit, because it's helped me a lot. It's called Taylor Pearson's course. He has a course called The Effective Entrepreneur. So that's what I've been using a lot lately. But basically, thinking about everything in 90-day increments really helps. So if you have some awesome idea, you know, you're going to have a lot of time to try it out in the grand scheme of things in the long term. So just kind of getting really focused for 90 days and thinking of everything like an experiment. If it works, then continue on with it. If it doesn't, or you want to try something else, do it in 90 days from now. But, you know, that's how I've kind of been able to avoid some shiny object syndrome. But I still get it all the time. You know, it's just sort of about plugging things into a spreadsheet as an idea or whatever, and then just thinking about that again in 90 days.
I love this. So this is brilliant. So I do this with both things I purchase. So on Amazon, if I want to buy anything, it has to go on a wish list for 30 days. And I do it in business as well, the best I can, to have a 30-day kind of running calendar of anything I want to try now that I'm like, oh, after I record this show with Dan, I could totally try this new Facebook ad campaign technique or retargeting or whatever it is. Or, you know, account management with my customers, a different way of going about it for previous show sponsors. I always put it 30 days ahead of my calendar. And then what I find is 30 days when I get to it, I'm like, that wasn't the best idea. And because I've got something new and exciting. And so I never end up doing them then. And I just end up doing the process that drives behind it. So I'm excited you said that, because that's very similar to the hack I've put together to kind of put that into place as well.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, 90 days is I guess relatively arbitrary. As long as you're in control and you're not just getting pulled off different places, then that's what counts.
Good stuff. Well, Dan, for everyone who's excited about everything we talked about today, the account management side of things, where can we find out more about you? And then tell us a little bit about the books and that as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And if I can't hard sell on a sales podcast for salespeople, then where can I do it?
Go for it, man. Go for it.
So basically, they can get my book, Mastering Account Management. management, which I sell normally paperback for something like 15 or 20 bucks, by going to salesschema.com. That's sales and then schema as in schematic, salesschema.com/salesman. And they'll find it there.
Amazing stuff. We'll link to that in the show notes of this episode over at salesman.red. And with that, Dan, I want to thank you for your insights, mate. I want to thank you for kind of getting that level deeper into account management, kind of like taking that extra layer of the onion off, because clearly there's a real profit center is probably the wrong word terminology wise to describe it, but there's a real potential for a lot of businesses and a lot of salespeople to make their lives easier and earn more money in the same process. So I appreciate that, mate. And I want to thank you for joining us on the Salesman Podcast.
Thank you, Will. Yeah, it was a lot of fun.